My name is Amrita Basu, and I teach in the departments of Political Science and Sexuality, Women's and Gender Studies, or SWAGS. I remember November 12th, the day students organized the sit-in at Frost Library so clearly. I was teaching a course on political identities, and we were going to be discussing race and racism that day. In fact, among the assigned readings for the class were articles on student protests at the murder of Michael Brown in Ferguson, Missouri. As I was walking to class, one of my students texted me and told me about the sit-in. So I headed over to Williston, where I was teaching, and I asked the 30 or so students in the course to accompany me to Frost. We stayed there through the afternoon, and I returned there several times over the weekend. It was a powerful experience. I was moved and saddened by the stories Black students told about their everyday experiences of racism in Val, the dorms, and in classrooms. And I was energized by their strength and courage. After the sit-in, I asked my students in political identities to write me letters in which they described the impact that the sit-in had on them. They talked about some of what they had written to me privately when we had class discussions, and those conversations were productive, but honestly, they were also very painful and difficult. I wrestled with how much to linger on students' personal experiences and how much to use the uprising as a way of learning about identities, resistance, and social change. So we did some of both. We talked about the role of students in activism historically, about why Black women had assumed the leadership of this protest, as of so many protests in the past, about how and why the protesters went from speaking out to formulating and then reformulating their demands, and about what happens to demands once they become institutionalized. I also found myself talking a lot to students about Amherst Uprising outside of class. Asian students spoke about their experiences of marginalization and invisibility. The South Asian students met with a group of South Asian faculty and then formed a group which is still meeting regularly to this day. SWAG students talked about their sense of not belonging because of their gender identities, sexual orientations, and class backgrounds. I became active in a faculty group that worked with the student activists and sought ways to foster more and better communication between students, faculty, and the administration. The Amherst Uprising brought about some important institutional change, like the creation of a presidential task force for diversity and inclusion, and the appointment of Norm Jones as the chief diversity and inclusion officer. But so much remained to be done, and all of this came into sharp relief this past spring. Then, as 5 years earlier, there was a synergy between racism and anti-racist activism on our campus and in the country as a whole. As in 2015, racism at Amherst College, which culminated in an incident involving the lacrosse team, occurred amidst police brutality against African Americans, the murders of Tony McDade, Breonna Taylor, George Floyd, Ahmaud Arbery, and so many others. At Amherst College, Black students, and this time alums, took the lead in fighting back. They wrote letters, petitions, and created social media sites in which they recorded their experiences of racism and laid out their demands. This was a hard time to be organizing because the pandemic precluded the kind of sit-in that had taken place 5 years earlier. But activists found creative ways of making themselves heard. And because of the numbers of people who spoke out and the clarity and force of their demands, the college listened. Last spring, while I was serving on the Committee of Six, we began meeting with members of the Black Student Union. We also invited them to a faculty meeting so our colleagues could hear from them directly. These conversations now involving alums, faculty, students, staff, and the administration, have continued. I'm currently co-chairing a committee with Karee Polk that Biddy created to address racism at the college. We're reviewing her anti-racism plan of August 2020 to see how we can realize and build on the goals she laid out. Among the questions we're asking are, what can we do to hire and retain more Black faculty? How can we try and ensure that all students learn about race and racism before they graduate from Amherst College, which is, of course, a complicated question given the open curriculum? How can we demand more accountability when incidents of bigotry occur? I'm aware of how difficult it is to change the character of this institution, but I also believe there's more will at the college to do so now. I attribute that in part to the nationwide Black Lives Matter movement. More locally, I attribute that in part to what Amherst Uprising made possible.